It's our pleasure to have Ajahn Nitish with us today. He's going to talk about his recent work, Thai Monetary Policy and Inflation and the Determinacy. Ajahn Nitish, the floor is yours.
So today I'm going to present the Thai Monetary Policy, Trend, Inflation and the Determinacy. Have a look at the outline of my presentation today. So start with introduction. Motivation and contribution, and looking at the models. And then we're going to derive the Phillips curve with trade inflation. Then we estimate the model using the Bayesian techniques, and then have a look at the optimum stabilization policy. And then look at the issues we call the anchoring expectations, and wrap up with the implications for the monetary policy and the conclusion. Let me begin with the, so during 1960 to 1978, before Paul Volcker became the Fed chairman, inflation was high during that time. But since 1980, during Volcker and Greenspan years, inflation was much lower. Then we call that the Great Moderation. So during the high inflation, during the high inflation, the Fed increased its policy rate by smaller amount, and the economy was unstable and inflation spiraled out of control. And yeah, that was Taylor, Carida, Karim, Gardler proposed that the Fed failed to respond sufficiently strongly to inflation, right? Leaving the US economy subject to self-fulfilling expectation driven fluctuations, or we call economy was in, indeterminacy, or expectation of inflation was not anchored, right? The Fed failed to respond. Okay, in their work, right? So the feedback on inflation was lower than one. So Taylor rules failed, and U.S. economy was unstable, right? But their analysis or them based on their models, so they built the model with zero inflation at a steady state, and in fact the average inflation at that time was about 4%. And Hornstein and Woolman, Kelly and S. Kelly and Rapelle, and discover an intriguing result, claim that the Taylor principle breaks down when trend inflation is positive. But in the central bank's inflation response satisfies the Taylor rule does not necessarily imply that the regional expectation equilibrium or determinacy could occur. And right, the notion of price stability in our theory and in the central bank practice today is typically associated with moderate rate of price inflation. Nonetheless, our most macroeconomic models for monetary policy analysis approximated around zero inflation at the steady state. Then zero inflation at the steady state is a simplification, but not really realistic or counterfactual assumption. As in S. Kelly and Rapelle and S. Karim Subordan. And so look at the Bank of Thailand. In Thailand, the Bank of Thailand adopted the inflation targeting regimes, framework since May 2000. So you can see that the central bank practice, pay attention or consider the trend inflation as well. If you look at Thailand's inflation, you can see that, during high inflation, but actually not high inflation, but relatively high inflation compared to from 2004 to 2014, average inflation about 3%, right? But from 2015 to 2021, inflation dropped to 0.12%. So we have two periods of relatively high inflation and relatively low inflation in Thailand. So we have trend inflation as well in entire economy. We're going to try to study these two periods. And look at my motivation. We're going to introduce trend inflation in the standard medium scale neo Keynesian theory, and then to investigate the implications of trend inflation for conduct of monetary policy for Thailand and during high and low level of inflation, to evaluate the effects of trend inflation on optimum stabilization policy. So we ask, we have the research question, is there any strategy to have the stabilization policy for Thai economy for Thai monetary policies. Also, we're going to investigate trend inflation and the anchoring of expectations. So again, we have the questions. Is there any type of the rule that would be more safely guaranteed determinacy for Thai economy? We want to set up the monetary policy parameters for Thailand that consistent with the determinacy. Yeah, consistent with the rational expectation equilibrium, right? And inflation could be anchor, right? Okay, so this is our motivation. Then the contributions. This study provides theoretical results on the effects of monetary policy in the standard medium-sized Neo-Keynesian models with positive trend inflation. And it also combines this theory results with empirical evidence for Thai economy during high and during low inflation periods. And then what we do here is we want to get the policy rules or policy parameters for zero trend inflation as a benchmark. And then we add trend inflation and we increase trend inflation and we see how the trend could change the policy prescription for Thai economy. Then two ways to do this, to achieve this. We estimate the Bank of Thailand reaction function for high and low inflation environment and using Bayesian estimation. And then we analyze how trend inflation causes variation in impact of policy shocks, consider monetary policies, fiscal policies, and like technology shock, right? In terms of responses of welfare loss, we focus on welfare loss to answer the first question. To answer the second question, we evaluate the Thai monetary policy rule based on the determinacy. And our approach is to search for the lowest possible feedback on inflation that consistent with the determinacy. Look at the, so here the models. Again, this standard medium scale, Neo-Keynesian models, but we accounting for trend inflation. So households like to consume, final consumption goods at lower cost, and household optimize their utility function with respect to budget constraint, and difference follow external habit formation. The constraints, that equations. Most of the literatures when they do Neo-Keynesian models, the utility function, they use the separated utility function, but in here, so we use non-separated utility function. And so we have law of motion of capital, right? And with the adjustment cost, we have capital in the model as well. Yeah. For the firms, we have final goods sector, aggregate intermediate goods into a single composite good, and intermediate goods sector. So we have the production function for each firms, and then production function. So we have capital as well. But most literature, for the basic Keynesian model, there is no capital. But in here, we put capital in there as well. Yeah, and we have capital, accumulation with adjustment cost. And so we have cargo price setting. And after that, we obtain optimum price behavior of the intermediate firms, right? And it's gonna be, we done this and here, And so this monetary policy rule. For monetary policy rule, we set up the trail rules in the log form. And then we have four shocks. We have technology shock, government spending shock, and markup price shock, and interest rate shock, or monetary policy shock. So here's price dispersions. The price set up by intermediate firms, difference across the firms, then resulting in unequally allocated resources across intermediate groups. Then price dispersion generates an inefficient resource allocation and causes the loss of aggregate output. Price dispersion depends on trend inflation. If you look at the equation, so price dispersion follow first order difference equation, delta T, that is price dispersion. And if you consider at the steady state, the price dispersion depends on trend inflation. And price dispersion depends on trend inflation. When trend inflation rises, marginal cost falls, then price dispersion rises and then causes a lower output in the long run. So we can see that we have the long run inflation output trade-off in the choice of trend inflation. And we can talk about this again when we derive the long run Phillips curve trend inflation. So then we in the new Keynesian economy, price dispersion is a crucial factor that can have the negative long run output and inflation trade-off. But this is important. If we have no price dispersion, the whole thing, the whole analysis would be we cannot do the whole analysis. So price dispersion is the key parameters in new Keynesian economy. Right. And so like this. Then we derive the optimum price. Yeah, we've got price dynamics evolve according to, we've got three equations, XT, MT, and MMT, right? And yeah, so this is a Phillips curve with trend inflation. Following Ascali and Sabordan 2014, then we substitute MT and MMT in XT, yeah. And then we log and analyze it. Then we have to find MMT hat T plus one. Then we combine cover equations, yeah, with the XT, yeah, and equation. Then we update one period to get MMT hat T plus one. And then we have the Phillips curve with trend inflation. Okay, so which is in the screen here. Right. In fact, two ways to derive the Phillips curve with trend inflation, we can do with the summation, summation and plus, many, many terms. But we could do this way. So we don't, we sort of like transform summation into expectation size here. And yeah, we could, this way, this is what I derive the Phillips curve with trend inflation. So when we substitute out the marginal cost and log realized, show with the log realized expression, so we've got, this is the Phillips curve with trend inflation. And we can see that Phillips curve now is more complicated if we put trend inflation in the model. If you have no trend inflation, Phillips curve is just like when we study in undergrad or even graduate levels, it's simple, right? But with trend inflation, Phillips curve is more complicated. Phillips curve composed of three equations. We got pi t hat and mt hat, that forward looking marginal cost, and delta t hat is a first order difference equation in the price dispersions. We got a system of three first order difference equations characterize the new Keynesian Phillips curve under trend inflation. And yeah, so this is very much different from what we have learned, right? And right, so since we got the Phillips curve, we can derive the demand curve. Yeah. So the demand curve, we log linearized derivative function and substitute out the optimum condition in Euler equations. And we got aggregate demand as we have seen here. And I did not do this. This is Natanan did. She is our students, undergrad students, helped me to do this, right? And yeah, so we got Phillips curve with trend inflation. So we got the demand curve with trend inflation. So sort of like we have the economy, right? We can analyze the economy with trend inflation. And right, so we can draw some conclusion for the economy with trend inflation. So the trend inflation leads to a smaller coefficient on current output gap and a larger coefficient on future expected inflation, right? Which means short run new Keynesian Phillips curve flattens, flattens, right? And which means the contemporaneous relation between inflation and output gap progressively weakens, because Phillips curve is flat, then the relationship between inflation and output is weak, it's weaker, right? Then the inflation rate becomes less sensitive, right, to variation in output gap or to current economic condition and more forward-looking. Then monetary policy should respond more strongly to inflation, to induce a reduction in output, right, that achieve a given change in inflation. Right, so we say the feedback on inflation should be larger, right, when trend inflation is higher, right? So monetary policy is less effective in the sense that to achieve a given change in inflation, the current output gap has to vary much more because trend inflation is trend, because with trend inflation, the Phillips curve is flatter. And next, then we have a look at the Bayesian estimation. So we the observables are in quarterly basis, and all series are seasonally adjusted. Then we did this in two periods, a high and low inflation period. The data that we use are GDP, real GDP, real GDP deflator, and Bank of Thailand policy rate. And so we put the data in the model and estimate the model parameters. The Bayesian estimation with high inflation period, right? And so we estimate the feedback output gap, right? Feedback inflation, feedback output gap, feedback inflation, and the persistencies of the interest rate. Right? So in high. We did this for high and low inflation period. So it turned out to be that feedback of output gap lower in low inflation period, but feedback in inflation on inflation higher in low inflation period, and the lag interest rate about the same, but the value is quite high. So the difference that we put the data then put in here is the inflation as a disease trend growth rate on nominal interest rate. So this is difference during this these two periods, high and low inflation environment, and with some other growth difference, also labor supply difference too. Okay, so we have the policy parameters, we have the parameters of the economy, then we can estimate. So this, we did this based on degree of price stickiness 0.75, the degree of price stickiness 0.75, and okay, so right, so we have the model parameters, the policy parameters. Now we're gonna try to evaluate the stabilization policies, right? With trend inflation, closing the output gap is not sufficient to stabilize inflation. If we have no inflation, if we closing output gap, right, then the inflation is stabilized, and that we call divide coincidence, you know, as Blanchard and Kali suggested. But that is no longer true when we have the trend inflation in the models in the economy. So as we can see from the Phillips curve, right, with trend inflation. Now we're gonna have a look at the loss function, right? We follow quadratic loss function by Woodford, Ascari, Ropele, and Largo and Elwes, right? And you can see that in loss function, we have the parameter V is the relative wedge, right? Between output and inflation, stabilization around the target. Okay? And we have some parameters to explain this relative weight, and relative weight now depend on trend inflation. Well, the results would be so we calculate the relative weight and welfare loss, right, for high and low inflation environments. For both high and low inflation environments, relative weights are decreasing with trend inflation. You can see the relative weights on output, right? High inflation period and low inflation period, the relative weights are decreasing as trend inflation rising. Right? And then the relative weights, the welfare loss are increasing with trend. More trend inflation, more welfare loss. So in both periods. Then the relative weights and the welfare losses are smaller for low period, low inflation period compared to high inflation period and low inflation environments. The lower inflation environments have, you know, low welfare losses. And if we decompose the shock into technology shock, then for technology shock, technology shock generates high inflation, okay? High inflation variation, then variation of output, you can see here, inflation is 2.773, 1.744, and output variation much lower, yeah, according to this shock, right? And yeah, so we have the common features. So we got in both high and low inflation periods, the relative weights are decreasing with trend inflation, and welfare losses are increasing with trend inflation, right? Okay. And right, if we look at the government spending shock, government spending shock on the other hand, generate a high variation in output. You can see here, 1.299 and 3.088, right? Generate a higher variation of outputs, right, in, you know, high and low inflation environments. And then yeah, we've got the same the common characters, yeah, for both high and low inflation periods. The relative weights are on output variations decreasing with trend inflation, okay? And high trend inflation, relative weight keep falling down, and welfare losses, you know, increasing with trend inflation. So the more inflation, the more trend inflation, then the welfare loss, you know, so that's the welfare loss. And right, so this is the interest rate shock. Interest rate shock generates compared to the government spending shock or technology shocks, generate lower variance, yeah, of both inflation and outputs. Yeah, but we compare between inflation and output variations. Inflation, the interest rate shock generate more, right, or higher inflation variations, okay, than output variations. Okay. And then we get the same characteristics for the welfare analysis. Then the relative weights are decreasing with trend inflation, and welfare losses are increasing with trend inflation. And right, so we can draw some conclusions here for optimum stabilization policy. In high inflation environment, a high level of trend inflation magnifies the welfare loss. Right. Then regardless of the shocks, the relative weight is decreasing. Yeah, and the welfare is increasing with trend inflation. And in both periods, technology shock and interest rate shock cause a higher variation in inflation. Right. Nonetheless, the government spending shock leads to a higher variation in output. Right. But among the shocks, the technology shock generates the highest welfare loss, but the interest rate shocks generates the lowest welfare loss. Right, so we can say that the policy prescriptions change under positive trend inflation, right, under positive trend inflation. So optimum policy has a lower weight on output gap variation or a higher weight on inflation variation when the target level of inflation is higher, right? So high level of inflation magnifies the welfare loss. According to Sabordan 2007, when the loss function is welfare based, then inflation stabilization weight increases in the policymaker's loss function. So this is consistent of the empirical studies that we found here for Thai economy. So the optimum policy, you know, when we have trend inflation, we should put more output feedback on output variations, or should lower feedback on, should lower weight, that weight on output variations and higher weight on inflation variation. So that is the optimum stabilization policy. Now turn to answer our second questions, right? So trend inflation and the anchoring expectations. Following the Woodford, the rational expectation equilibrium, REE, right, REE, can be derived from the Taylor principle as follows, right? And with this Taylor principles, right, then the condition above, right, generalize that the original Taylor principle require the inflation feedback on inflation bigger than one, right? So because of what? Because you know the partial derivative of output over the partial derivative of inflation in the long run equal to zero when no trend inflation. So that's why the feedback on inflation must bigger than one. Yeah, no trend inflation. When no trend inflation, this term will be zero. Yeah, this term will be zero. Yeah, no trend inflation. Okay. Then the slope of long run Phillips curve is flat. So that's what we understand, you know. That's what we remember when we study, you know, undergrad or, you know, the graduate level theory. Okay. And so when feedback of inflation bigger than one, okay. So what do we mean by that? Then Taylor principle, short run nominal interest rate should rise more than an increase in inflation in long run. So in long run, inflation in long run is trend inflation, right? Then if this is the case, then the feedback on output is not important. Yeah, because the slope of long run Phillips curve equal to zero if we have no trend inflation. Yeah. Nonetheless, with trend inflation, the Taylor principles only hold as the necessary conditions for the rational expectation equilibrium determinacy. So now here, then with trend inflation, then the slope of long run Phillips curve now is heavily complicated, right? And can be written as, you know, to find the slope of long run Phillips curve with trend inflation, then firstly we have to find the Phillips curve with trend inflation first, and then we move, you know, output to the left hand side, and you know, like here. So back to the Phillips curve with trend inflation. Here. So we move yt hat to the left hand side and we partial derivative these three equations with respect to inflation. And again, so Natanan did this. Okay, Natanan derived the long run Phillips curve. Yeah, long run Phillips curve with trend inflation. And yeah, this is what she kept right here. Okay, so all this, right? And yeah, it look complicated, it's heavily complicated. Yeah, but yeah, we can analyze it. Right, and then so we know that slope of long run Phillips curve negative. You can see that if we increase trend inflation, right, then the slope of long run Phillips curve negative, right? Yeah, look at this graph, and then we did this with the degree of price signal as 0.75, right? And let's see. Okay. And we also found that at a high level of price thickness, like 0.75, the labor supply at steady state makes no difference in short run, in slope of the long run Phillips curve. You can see that the value of labor supply at the steady state cannot influence the slope of long run Phillips curve. But I'm gonna move this. If we look at this, if we on the right hand side here, if we lower degree of price signal to 0.5, and we can see that the steady state labor supply can influence the slope of the long run Phillips curve. Okay. And right, let Okay, discuss on the slope of the long run Phillips curve. So as trend inflation rises, then the slope of long run Phillips curve switch side from positive to negative. And this is different from what we learned in undergrad or in graduate level, because we remember that if economy is operate at potential in the long run, there's no long run, there's no trade off between inflation and inflation and output at all. If economy is operate at medium run or long run, then no trade off between inflation and output. But that's not no longer true when we put trend inflation in the model economy, right? And you know, many economists do not believe this. They don't believe this. Well, they believe in, you know, money is neutral in the long run, okay, but not whole anymore, not valid anymore with trend inflation, because trend inflation rises, you know, slope is negative, then trend inflation rises, then output fall, right? So if this is the case, if we have the negative slope of long run Phillips curve, then the trade-off between monetary policy parameter disappear. Feedback, the trade-off between feedback on inflation and feedback on output gap disappears. So if central bank, which means implying that if central bank would like to lower feedback on inflation, they must lower feedback on output gap as well with trend inflation. Then the slope of long run Phillips curve increases with trend inflation, right? And now with trend inflation, then the feedback on output is important because slope of long run Phillips curve is no longer zero. Then, but this value, yeah. So the feedback on output gap, you know, cannot be neglected, and it should be generally very low for realistic value for trend inflation. Right. And then, so we look at we derive the determinacy condition. Okay. So above the line, which means economy is in determinacy region above the line. Yeah, above the line. Below the line means indeterminacy region, or the determinacy region, break down, or there's a threat to the determinacy region. Well, if you look at high inflation, then if you use the standard Taylor principles, let's say output gap, feedback on output gap 0.25, it 0.25, right? It is the star, right? Star line here. And then the alpha pi, the feedback on inflation 1.5. Yeah, so, well, if we have no inflation, no trend inflation, well, it's clearly must be in the determinacy region, it's safe, right? But with trend inflation about 4% per year, 4% per year, then results in the threat to determinacy region. And for the parameter that we calibrate, right, for Thai economy, clearly it would be, if they have no trend inflation, yeah, clearly it's gonna be in the determinacy region. But if we have trend inflation, so the trend inflation about 6%, nearly 7% here, nearly 7% per year, that results in the threat to determinacy. For the low inflation environment, pretty much the same, but slightly different, right? For the Taylor principle, the standard value, right? With trend inflation, about 5% here, results in the threat to the determinacy region. But for Thai economy that we calibrate using the Taylor rules, right? 6%, right? More than, slightly more than 7% trend inflation results in the threat to the deterministic region. Then the the smallest feedback on inflation, values consistent with determinacy deviate from the original trailer principle. As you can see, we have trend inflation. It imposes the threat to determinacy region. So during high inflation environment, achieve determinacy regions require a minimum feedback on inflation, 1.1, 1.25, 1.6, and 2.8 for a trend inflation to 4, 6, and 8% respectively. But during low inflation environment, so achieving determinacy requires a minimum of feedback on inflation, 1.1, 1.25, then 1.4, 2.5 for a trend inflation, like 2, 4, 6, 8% respectively. And we can see here, low inflation environments require low feedback on inflation. But during the mild trend inflation, the value of theta pi about the same. But when 6%, 8% trend inflation, right, for low periods, low inflation environments require lower feedback on inflation, which means more safe to be in the determinacy region. Yeah. So these findings, while consistent with Khan, Panuf, and Victor 2020, suggest that proposals to raise inflation target are dependent of the systematic response of monetary policy to inflation. Which means when we consider to adjust inflation targeting rate, so we have to that is not independent with the monetary policy rules. We have to look at what feedback on output, right? Get feedback on inflation as well to stay in the determinacy region, so with trend inflation, okay? And a high inflation target makes the anchoring of inflation expectation more difficult for the central bank. Then this is what we looking for. This is what we want to have, right? We want to set up the monetary policy prescription for Thai economy associated with the regional expectation equilibrium determinacy, right? Right, so we asked what factor really influence the determinacies. Actually, between high and low inflation environments, we change several factors to see that the deterministic condition change or not. But we found that the factor that really influence the deterministic region is the degree of price thickness. So that's why we make two set of the price thickness, 0.75 and 0.5 here, to have the monetary policy prescriptions, right? And so we vary value of the alpha y or feedback on output, like 0.2, 0.4, 0.6, 0.8, and then we vary the trend inflation, annually, like 2-4-6%, and then with different degree of price thickness, 0.75, 0.5, right? And then we find the response, the minimum response of feedback on inflation consistent with the determinacy. Okay, this is what we looking for or what we want to have, right? So let's say if for Thai economy, if feedback on output gap 0.2, right, and trend inflation is 4%, right, then the degree of price thickness is, let's say we assume that the degree of price thickness 0.75, then the feedback on inflation, the minimum would be 1.3371 here, right here. And I think this value is consistent with Ascari and Sbordan suggest. So they say that if alpha y about 0.2, right, it trend inflation about 6%, and then the theta pi should be bigger than 2%, should be bigger than 2, which is, you know, we got 1.9055 here. So let's say if we have, if we set alpha y 0.4, feedback on output gap 0.4, and then we say, trend inflation about 4%, then the central bank would set feedback on inflation bigger than 1.6742 in order to be in the deterministic region, right? So this is the sort of like time monetary policy prescriptions, right? Consistent with the deterministic region. And yeah, so we can summarize here. To be guaranteed in the deterministic, the feedback on output should be low, right? And the feedback of output gap should be high. Yeah, the feedback output should be low, and the feedback on, to guarantee in the deterministic, the feedback on output gap should be low, right? And the feedback on inflation should be high. Yeah, okay, so this is a typo here. And yeah, okay, so we got some implications for monetary policies. The as inflation rises, when monetary rules call for increasing large and positive feedback on inflation, when pi bar goes up, then alpha pi should be larger, right? And alpha y should be lower, small feedback on output gap. Then eventually, for large enough values of trend inflation, then central bank has no choice but being on inflation targeter. So forget about output gap, right? If inflation is very, very high, right? For Thai economy, then even though the monetary policy rules are safe in the deterministic region, you know, both high and low inflation periods, but trend inflation results in threat to the determinacy. Then comes to conclusion then. So monetary policy is less effective when trend inflation rises, because to achieve the same amount of inflation, then the output variation, you know, is larger. Optimum policy has a lower wage on output gap volatility, or a higher wage on inflation volatility when the target level of inflation is higher. Then a high level of trend inflation magnifies the welfare loss. Then moderate level of trend inflation could alter the deterministic region and changing the Taylor principle. And yeah, as in Khan et al. 2020, the particular choice of monetary policy rule can have important implications for macroeconomic stability. At the end, right, we sum up with this one. The higher trend inflation tends to decrease average output and anchor inflation expectation, increase volatility of the economy, worsen policy trade-off, and reduce welfare. And yes, that pretty much is the presentation.
Let's unmute ourselves and give Ajahn Nipit a big round of applause. Yeah. And ขอบคุณครับอาจารย์นิพิษ